Hello everyone, Omores here. Today we're checking out one of the most requested Windows versions on this channel, Windows XP x64. So far, we've seen a lot of action with the regular 32-bit XP, which by now we definitely know that can handle modern hardware. But since newer systems usually come loaded with tons of RAM, there is still this feeling that some potential is being wasted, especially because the 32-bit edition can handle only 4 GB of RAM, and in practice it's often even less. Windows XP x64 Professional Edition, on the other hand, supports up to 128 GB of RAM. So why haven't I installed it until now? Why? Well, if we try using an original installation disk on modern hardware, we'll just get a blue screen. I know, it's old news. So we obviously need an updated disk. But in practice, it's way easier to find an updated 32-bit, or let's call it x86 edition, like the Integral Edition, which even has a 2025 release. But as someone on Reddit pointed out, where is the x64 Integral Edition? Well, there is no such thing as an x64 Integral Edition. Sure, there are a few similar x64 versions out there packed with updates in drivers, but I've tested some of them and they just don't work on the 13th gen test system we're using here. So why not make a new ISO that actually works with a very modern hardware? You know, the kind that's still on the market. Turns out it's not even that complicated. I'll show you how I did it in a moment, but before I get into how I put it all together, let me ask, have you ever watched me install Windows 98 or XP? If so, you know I don't just get the job done, I explain why things break, what causes the errors, and why certain patches or workarounds are needed. Because to me, understanding how and why something works is just as important as making it work. And that's where Brilliant, the sponsor of this video, comes in. Think of it as a gym membership, but for your brain. Brilliant's interactive lessons don't just throw information at you, they help you truly understand things, whether it's computer science, math, logic, programming, or even how AI really works. Brilliant walks you through everything step by step. Personally, I've been going lately through their AI courses. Sure, we all know what AI is, but I wanted to really dive into how it works behind the scenes. So, if you're curious like me, head over brilliant.org/omores to start your 30-day free trial and get smarter every day. Plus, if you use that link, you'll get 20% off an annual premium subscription. And speaking of solving problems, now let's see how modern our hardware really needs to be before it becomes a problem for Windows XP x64. So what counts as a very modern hardware for Windows XP? Well, officially XP is supported up to Intel's 3rd generation CPUs, but the 4th gen Haswell systems still play nicely with both 32 and 64-bit editions. The issues begin with the Intel's 6th generation of hardware, where Windows XP throws an, let's call it A05 error related to ACPI, and despite the message on the screen, which is the same for both 32 and 64-bit editions, we no longer have the option to bypass ACPI by installing Windows in a standard PC mode or using legacy MPS support. This was never a problem with the 32-bit edition or older Windows NT systems. In fact, that's why we can still install something like Windows 2000 or even Windows NT on very modern hardware, just by ignoring ACPI completely and relying on the standard PC architecture or MPS, which can enable multiprocessor support. But XP x64 is different, it's based on the Server 2003 code and requires ACPI compliance. And this is where things break if our hardware is too new, like this ASUS Socket 1700 motherboard used for testing, which is a 2022 model. The core issue is that Windows XP x64 only supports up to ACPI 2.0, and even that support is partial, while modern motherboards now use ACPI 6. Thankfully, ACPI is designed to be backward compatible, so the older ACPI 2.0 tables are still present, and anything newer beyond the XP's understanding should be safely ignored. But as we are getting the A05 error, something clearly is not working. The good news is that there is a new ACPI driver released in November 2024 for the X64 edition, so I guess that's all we need. I found it on the MSFN forum, where most of the latest XP mods are shared. The modified driver is called acpi.sys, likely released by Skullteria or possibly a collaboration with Dietmar, another heavy and well-known XP modder. There is no information or instructions included, but I think I know the drill. Some instructions, actually a lot of them, are already out there on the My Digital Life forum, but honestly the whole procedure feels a bit overcomplicated. I did use the XP X64 service pack to ISO recommended there, but for the rest, let's keep it simple. Here's what we need to do. First, we need a clean, untouched Windows XP service pack to ISO, which needs to be extracted into a folder. And this is the folder we'll later use with Nlight, a tool that really needs no introduction. Next, we have to replace the original acpi.sys and halsys files with the patched versions. Since this is the X64 version, these files are located inside the AMD64 folder. And one very important step, we need to compress both files using the makecab command, just like I showed earlier. We also need to add AHCI/SATA support to avoid hitting the next blue screen, the one with 07B error, which is related to disk hardware. The motherboards that will trigger the ACPI error usually don't have the option to emulate SATA drives as IDE devices anymore, and the AHCI protocol used for SATA SSDs is basically unknown to Windows XP. So this step is crucial. There are plenty of compatible AHCI drivers out there, but I use the Intel AHCI driver from the WinRAID forum. It's reliable, I've used it before, and it's easy to integrate with Nlight. Just keep in mind this is an Intel AHCI driver and won't work with AMD chipsets. Now that we have the ISO ready, we have two installation options. Plan A, burn the ISO to a CD and install from a SATA drive. Plan B, use a USB drive instead. Though this can be a bit more complicated, but if it works, why not? For now, let's proceed with plan A and install from the optical drive. This time there is no plan C, like in the 32-bit version, where we could also start the setup directly from the SSD by preparing a DOS bootable partition, as I've shown here before. The DOS method bypasses both USB and optical drives. I really prefer this approach. But the x86 edition is different. It's based on Windows Server 2003, so DOS isn't part of the process here. And back to our setup. Everything seemed on track. No ACPI blue screen. The SATA SSD was recognized without any issues. And just when I thought I was finally going to see the desktop for the first time, right after the first restart, bam, the ACPI error came back. So what's going on? Well, I pulled the installation SSD, connected to my PC, and found that the patched acpi.sys had been overwritten by the version inside the sp2cab file, which comes with the service pack too. Next time I build an x64 ISO, I'll replace the files inside the sp2cab as well. That might not be as easy as it sounds, though, since that cabinet file is probably signed. Anyway, for the moment, the fix was simple. I manually replaced the acpi.sys once again, this time directly inside the Windows folder /system32/drivers. And that was it. Finally, Windows XP x64 was running on my 13th gen build. You've seen this configuration plenty of times, but this is the final chapter. The ASUS H610 motherboard with a classic PCI slot has been passed on to a friend. It's time for some fresh gear. Now, since we're talking hardware, for this setup, I also used a PCIe to USB 2 adapter with a NEC chip. Wasn't necessary since we can get the USB 3X controller to work, but since I had it lying around, why not? Plus, it made it easy to plug in a Wi-Fi stick and start updating right away. And speaking of updates, one of the best things to happen for legacy operating systems like Windows XP has to be a legacy update. This is a small utility that redirects Windows Update to alternate legacy servers, delivering updates just like it used to back in the day, watching all those updates download and install one by one. Well, oddly satisfying. Sure, it takes a while, but at least we know exactly what we're running since we started with a clean ISO patch with just two files and AHCI drivers. I know some people don't fully trust the x86 Integral Edition, mostly because they're unsure how it was built or what's inside. I get it. Personally, I have no issues with the Integral Edition, but I also enjoy keeping things simple. Once the updates were done, I installed the NVMe and USB 3 drivers. Ideally, this would be integrated into the installation ISO, so it have support from the very start. While that should be possible, some drivers just don't play nice during setup, especially if specific updates are missing. For instance, NVMe support requires a specific store port update, which I did integrate into the ISO along with the actual drivers. However, the drive wasn't recognized during setup, even though the same drivers worked flawlessly afterwards. Packing the setup with more updates may do the trick. The good news is that NVMe installation via control panel, it's very easy. We just need to identify which unknown PCI device is the NVMe controller and load the drivers. I used the exact same drivers that I showed you in the Windows Vista 64 video. These two systems are both built on the Server 2003 code base, and as long as the driver doesn't require Vista-specific functions, it should work in both, and it does. The speeds are really good, up to maximum specification of this Samsung NVMe SSD, which is a model from around 2015. Next, I installed the sound driver. No problem in this department. The HDMI audio works as well. For browsing, we can use a Supermium, which is a Chromium fork, and it's very up-to-date. As of today, it will work with everything, including YouTube. We can also download the latest version of the DirectX 9 package from the Microsoft website. It still receives minor updates. For graphics, as I've shown in my previous videos, we can use up to NVIDIA GTX 980 GPUs. There is a lot of raw power in this card, especially for DirectX 9 and older games. Anyway, for the setup, I tested a single-slot Quadro 2000 card, which back in the day was basically a more expensive GTX 450. Even with this card, we can dive into some serious gaming, think Crysis, Skyrim, even GTA 5. Just keep in mind we're still in the Windows XP territory, so the newest games that will eventually run are from about 10 years ago. In the end, let's answer a few questions I'm sure will pop up. Can we use this ISO I made to install Windows XP x64 from USB? Well, yes and no. Since the ISO has no USB 3X support included, the installation will end with a 007 BSOD, as tested by me. However, when I plugged the same USB stick made with Win setup from USB into a NEC PCIe to USB 2 controller, which is natively supported by Windows XP, the installation went fine. So I guess it should work as soon as we have USB 3 support during setup. However, you should still consider getting a PCIe to USB 2 adapter, as these cards are natively supported and can solve many issues, especially when there are no PS2 ports available. As for installing the USB 3 drivers, they install just fine like the NVMe drivers, but speeds seems to be capped at USB 3.0 limits, around 500 megabytes. Still not bad, but this H610 motherboard supports USB 3.1 Gen 2 and can deliver up to 1 gigabyte per second. And speaking of this motherboard, before saying goodbye, I updated the BIOS to the latest version from May 2025. Naturally, I had to test Windows XP x64 one more time, and the good news is the update didn't break the ACPI compatibility. It still works great. I know I didn't talk much about running Windows XP on AMD hardware. Don't worry, the ACPI patch can get the job done there as well. It works on my AM4 setup with an X4070 motherboard and a Ryzen 9 3900X, though we'll need to use a different ACI drivers. Now, if you want the ISO I made, all the drivers I used in this video, plus the ones I tested on my AMD setup, you'll find them along with a detailed tutorial on my Patreon page. Don't worry, you can join for free, and of course, I wouldn't mind if you feel like buying me a coffee or supporting the project. Some of you are already doing that, and I truly can't thank you enough. Thanks for watching, and a big thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video.